Hello student, welcome to another session of the reproductive system, that is pregnancy and lactation. Now the ovum, once it is ovulated, once it is released, now it will be able to survive for 72 hours or say. But though it is able to survive for 72 hours, it was in the study seen that it is fertilizable only for very few hours. But when it comes to the sperms will be able to be, they remain viable for a very long time. So the chances of the pregnancy will be much more if the copulation or the coitus takes place immediately after the ovulation. Normally the ovum will be carried towards the ampulla of the uterus, and that is the uterine tube, and the sperms, those the normal site for the fertilization is the ampulla of the uterine tube. Once the ampulla, that is the fertilization, has taken place now, so what are the steps that are taking place in the fertilization? So suppose this is the ovum which is being released, and this is the sperm. Now the sperm will have the head, and head will have the acrosome cap on it. Now this is the ovum will be surrounded by the zona pellucida. The sperm will be attracted towards the ovum by chemo attraction. As we have seen that the sperm will have the olfactory receptors, so that it can sense the chemical substance, and because of the chemo attraction, the sperm will be attracted to us. Once it is near, the sperm is near to the this, what is going to happen is the acrosome reaction. That means this acrosome, that is the acrosomal enzymes, it will break up, the content will be released, that is the lysosomal enzymes that will be released, and the sperm, the acrosome will try to penetrate the zona pellucida and the membrane of the ovum. This is called as acrosome reaction. So in the acrosome reaction, the enzymes which are released, they will penetrate the zona pellucida and ultimately the cell membrane, and the head will go inside, the head which contains mainly the chromosomal part or the DNA part, it will go inside the ovum, that is the cell of the ovum. How does the binding of the sperm head take place with the zona pellucida? It is because of one protein which is called as fertiline. This protein will act as a binding protein, or it will give a signal where the attachment should take place. This fertiline is present over the sperm head. So this is required for the fusion of the sperm head with the ovum. The next important question is that there are so many sperms which are tries to fertilize the ovum. But at the same time, only one sperm should fertilize the ovum. Once the one sperm head enters the ovum, for the rest of the sperms, the ovum should become, the barrier should be formed, so that the rest of the sperm head cannot enter. Polyspermy should be prevented. Now the question is that how the polyspermy is prevented? Why only one sperm is able to fertilize the ovum? The certain changes which are taking place. As I told you, the fertiline, which will act as a signal marker. So the fertiline which is present over the sperm head, once it binds with the zona pellucida, it will send signal over the cell membrane of the ovum. And for some time, the membrane potential will decrease. So this decrease in the membrane potential will inhibit entry of the other sperm. And later on, the structural changes in the zona pellucida will occur after some time, so that which will prevent the entry of the some other sperms. Implantation. Now once this the fertilization has taken place, now this will call it as a blastocyst. Now the blastocyst will start its journey towards the uterus. In that journey, the cell division will start. It will go for the 2 cell stage, then 4 cell stage, 16 cell stage, and up till it reaches to the 16 cell stage, it reaches near to the posterior wall of the uterus. That remains a favorite site for the implantation. So once the cell starts dividing, the outer layer of the blastocysts, the cells, they merge with each other, and a layer which is formed, a polynuclear layer we can say, which is called as syncytotrophoblast. Syncytia means what? Number of cells acting together. Here it is a polynuclear cells. So cell membrane margins, they are not clear in this case. So therefore it is called as syncytotrophoblast, and the inner layer will be called as cytotrophoblast. So now the blastocyst has got the syncytotrophoblast, which is the outer layer, and the cytotrophoblast, which is the inner layer. This syncytotrophoblast will cause erosion of the endometrial mucosa, and ultimately the blastocyst will be implanted, or it will be buried into the endometrium of the uterus, and then later on the placenta will develop. So syncytotrophoblast is ultimately responsible for the implantation. Syncytotrophoblast has got some other functions also. It will synthesize an important hormone which is called as human chorionic gonadotropin. Now what is the functions of the gonadotropins? Gonadotropins are the required for the maintenance of the corpus luteum. They are required for the maintenance of the continuation of the corpus luteum. So this human chorionic gonadotropin will be released, and this will act over the corpus luteum so that the synthesis of the progesterone and estrogen by the corpus luteum can be continued. The human chorionic gonadotropin can be detected in the urine as early as about the 14 days after the conception. So what is the basis of the urine pregnancy test? Which metabolites of which hormones we are checking when the urine pregnancy test? This can be asked as a multiple choice question. So your answer should be human chorionic gonadotropin. Right? Now, the corpus luteum, which is synthesizing estrogen and progesterone. Function, it will continue up till the 8 to 14 weeks of pregnancy. And then afterwards, it will start slowly regressing when the placenta is fully developed now and the placenta is synthesizing estrogen and progesterone. Right? So, the corpus luteum is essential to continue the pregnancy at least up till the 8 weeks of the pregnancy. What are the other hormones related to the pregnancy? Estrogen and the progesterone level. Their level will go on increasing. They are the most essential to maintain the pregnancy. Just before the term or the completion, the level just, it will fall only after the placenta has been delivered. Otherwise, their level will become remain high. Next important hormone, which is synthesized by the syncytotrophoblast, is human chorionic somatomammotrophin. Now, as the name suggests, human chorionic somatomammotrophin. That means it has got similar function to the growth hormone. This hormone is also called as maternal growth hormone of the pregnancy. It is required to maintain the growth of the fetus, or the exact functions of related to that is not still not clear. But what we know is that the level of the human chorionic somatomammotrophin, it is similar to the level of the placental development. So if I measure the human chorionic somatomammotrophin level and if I found it to be less than normal, then I can say that the placental development is not to the gestational age. Right? So that becomes the importance of this hormone. Now when it comes to the pregnancy as such, what you should know is the concept of the fetoplacental unit. That means how the placenta and then fetal adrenal, how they act together to synthesize some hormones. This is called as fetoplacental unit. As you can see in this table now, this is the placenta, these are the cells, and this is the fetal adrenal. What the placenta will do? Placenta will convert cholesterol into pregnenolol. This pregnenolol can go to the fetal adrenal and can be converted into dehydroepiandrosterone. And from there, or even the progesterone from the placenta, it can go to the fetal adrenal, and the fetal adrenal will be able to synthesize cortisol and the corticosterone from that. Dehydroepiandrosterone will again go back to the placenta, and placenta will be able to synthesize estrogens from them. So what is important thing you have to know is that the placenta and the fetal adrenal, they will act as one unit to synthesize some hormones, mainly the estrogens and the progesterone. Now coming to the parturition or the delivery process. How to calculate the expected date of delivery? Expected date of delivery is calculated from the last day of the menstrual cycle. So it is 284 days from the last day of menstrual cycle. And as we all know that normally the ovulation will take place on the 14th day, and actually the fertilization will take place on the day of ovulation, let's say. So at least if we calculate that, it should be 270 days from the day of the fertilization. So it will become either 284 days from the last day of menstrual cycle, or it is the 270 days from the day of the fertilization. Now, what causes onset of labor? How the body knows that the fetus is mature enough to come out of the uterus, or when the actually the labor should start? Again, there are some hypotheses related to that. One hypothesis is that the estrogen and the progesterone level, they will go on increasing. So a certain level of the estrogen and progesterone level, high level is reached. And once that high level is reached, then the labor will start. It is also seen that just before the term, there is a increase in fetal hypothalamus and placental corticotropin releasing hormone. This corticotropin releasing hormone is required to increase the fetal ACTH and the cortisol levels. And these cortisols are very important for the maturation of the fetal respiratory system, mainly surfactant level. So cortisols, which are responsible for the maturation of the respiratory system, this will occur just before the term. And once the lungs are mature, the baby is now strong enough to come out of the uterus and to take its first breath. As we have seen in relation to that, a premature baby. What is the major problem in the premature baby? Is the respiratory distress syndrome. And it's because of the less amount of the surfactants related to that. Premature labor is again a common problem nowadays. And it has become a practice that those ladies with the history of the premature labor, they are given synthetic progesterones, which are given to prevent the premature labor. So that can be helpful. Now once the term has reached, now the process of the, that is the parturition starts, delivery starts. The cervix, which is quite functionally different that from the uterus, the cervix is formed up till the time of parturition. But when the parturition is, that is when the term is there, full term baby is there, the cervix becomes softer and it starts to dilate because of the some feeble contraction of the uterus. Remember, the uterus has been primed up by the estrogen, and now the because of that, the oxytocin receptors, the number of oxytocin receptors will be more number of gap junctions will be formed, and the oxytocin can easily act. Progesterone level will decrease, estrogen level will be high. So therefore, the oxytocin can easily act. The positive feedback mechanism of oxytocin will start now. Some contraction of the uterus will dilate the cervix. And from the cervix, the impulses will be sent to the hypothalamus and more synthesis of the oxytocin. It is going to cause further contraction of the uterus and further dilation of the cervix. So this is a good example of the positive feedback mechanism, right? It is also seen that prostaglandins facilitates the effect of the oxytocin. So prostaglandins are also important in causing the normal parturation. When it comes to the lactation, now what are the various hormones which are required for the lactation? Estrogen. Estrogen is mainly required for the proliferation of the mammary ducts. Progesterone will cause these mammary ducts which are being formed, the progesterone will cause the maturation of them and it will form the lobules. Prolactin, human chorionic gonadotropin are also helpful for the development of the breast during the pregnancy. But one important thing you have to remember is that estrogen antagonizes the milk producing effect of the prolactin. So estrogen, which will actually prevent the milk secretion and the milk letdown, it is prevented by the estrogen. But as soon as the placenta is delivered now, the estrogen and the progesterone level will come down and the prolactin level will increase. Prolactin level will remain high. So because of that now, the milk production as well as this letdown is going to start. Who causes milk letdown? Again, hormone oxytocin. Again, the positive feedback mechanism is involved in that. When the baby sucks the nipple, the touch receptors around the nipple and the areola, they will send signal to the hypothalamus. Because of that, oxytocin will be released. This oxytocin will act over the myoepithelial cells of the alveoli and lobules. And they will cause the contraction of the lobules and the alveoli, and ultimately the milk will be ejected out through the nipple. So this is called as milk letdown reflex. There is a concept that is called as lactation amenorrhea. It is because of the prolactin. Prolactin, if the mother is feeding up and because of that the prolactin level is high, the prolactin will inhibit the effect of the FSH and the LH. so that there is no ovulation, that is no follicular phase, no luteal phase, and there is no ovulation that is taking place. So this is called as lactation amenorrhea. Generally, it will continue for 25 to 30 weeks after the delivery.